It's the way it should be at Lambeau Field. Easy for us to say, but 60,000 people, they're used to it, they don't mind, they're pumped up, and here we go on Monday night. Antonio Chapman is back to receive. A look down at renovated and refurbished Lambeau Field. They started the construction project a couple of years ago. It is now completed, and the Packers begin the second half of the 2003 season right now, as do the Philadelphia Eagles, with David Akers to kick off. And here we go from Green Bay. 2 yards into the end zone, Chapman will down it there. And let's take a look at the Green Bay starting offense.
Brett Favre, Southern Miss. Amon Green, Nebraska.
William Henderson, UNC.
Donald Driver, Alcorn State.
Robert Ferguson, Texas A&M.
Bubba Franks, Miami Hurricanes.
Chad Clifton, Tennessee.
Mike Wall, Naval Academy.
Mike Flanagan, UCLA.
Marco Rivera, Penn State.
Mark Tauscher, Wisconsin.
For Brett Favre, he keeps adding to that mark that he broke long ago, formerly held by Ron Jaworski. 182 consecutive starts, and then you add in 17 playoff games along the way. He is indestructible. This is Amon Green coming off a great game last week at Minnesota, tackled by Mark Seminole after a 9.5-yard gain. It'll be second down and inches.
You see that formation? I'll guarantee you that's one that the Eagles haven't seen. Look at this. They have 1, 2, 3 backs. They have a fullback here in Lucci, a fullback here in Henderson, and of course right here the tailback in Amon Green. So they get Henderson blocking one side, Lucci blocking the other side, and Amon Green can cut to either side.
The power eye, and here goes Green cutting back, and Green has a first down and a 5-yard gain. And let's take a look at Philadelphia's starting defensive unit.
Brandon Whiting, California.
Corey Simon, Florida State.
Darwin Walker, Tennessee.
M.D. Kalu, Rice University.
Carlos Emmons, Arkansas State.
Mark Seminole, Kansas State.
Nate Wayne, Mississippi.
Troy Vincent, University of Wisconsin.
Michael Lewis, Colorado.
Clinton Hart, Central Florida Community College.
Leto Shepard, Florida.
Two key guys missing in the secondary most of the year. Brian Dawkins, the safety. Bobby Taylor, the corner. Favre rolling and looking and stopping and throwing and completing the pass for a gain of about 8 to Robert Ferguson. It'll be second down and 2. Seminole in on the tackle.
You're talking to Brett Favre the other day, Al. He was saying that's his game. It's not as much staying in the pocket and throwing the ball anymore, but moving. That time, they get in the shotgun. Now, most of the time when you get in the shotgun, you don't have a fake run or a bootleg. Watch him. Fake the run there, bootleg, move out to the right, throw the ball on the run. There's no one that does it better.
Off a quick count. It is Green, slipped down, gets back up, and let's see where they give him forward progress. It's close to a first down up at the 45-yard line.
Yeah, the Packers are really worried about the blitz. I mean, they know that, as we talked about earlier, that Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator of the Eagles, is going to blitz you anytime and maybe every time. So they're going to change up some things. They're going to go in the first count. They're going to go in the hard count. They're going to go in the long count to foul up their blitzes.
Four quick counts to this point. First and 10 from the 45-yard line. Here's Green again. And Green with a hard-earned 3-yard pickup, stopped by Whiting and Seminole. Amon Green, and as he goes this year, so go the Packers. When he has had a big day, Green Bay wins. When he has not, they have lost. He has been the key.
You know, and Brett Favre will be the first guy to say that, too. You know, I've always felt that the best friend of a quarterback is a good running back or a good running game. And talking to Brett Favre the other day, and he said the best thing we have going right now is Amon Green running.
And now they have Najee Davenport in on this play, and Favre loses the ball. And it's a free football, and it is Green Bay recovering. Mike Flanagan in the center alertly covers at the 30-yard line. So it was a fumble and not a forward pass. And then Green Bay, after the blitz by Nate Wayne, it's a 19-yard loss, but they retain possession.
That's the old empty hand. You know, we talked earlier about Brett Favre having a broken thumb, and a broken thumb is going to affect your release, and it's going to affect your grip. And you see, as he brought that ball back, the ball just went right out the back door of his hand.
And the irony is, all season he had not fumbled until then. He's taken about 500 snaps, but the combo of the thumb and the slick ball with the light rain, and it's his first fumble of the year. Now a draw to Green, or a draw rather to Tony Fisher on third and long, and Fisher, one of their three running backs, takes it up to the 37. And after a good beginning to this drive, they're forced to punt.
And that was the same thing that Brett was saying the other day about that broken thumb, that it affects his grip. It affects when he throws the ball. When it leaves his hand is when it hurts, or when he hands it off. Those are the three times it bothers him the most.
Josh Bidwell kicking Reno Mahe back to receive the kick. It's a short kick. Mahe calls for a fair catch at the 23-yard line. And that's where Philadelphia will take over for the first time tonight. 40-yard Bidwell boot, 10:47 left in the period. Just underway in Green Bay, no score. Arlington, Virginia, on the eve of Veterans Day. McNabb's first throw of the game is deflected and almost intercepted by Darren Sharper. Go for it, couldn't get it. And McNabb gets away with one right there on his first pass of the night.
Well, you know, we know that the Philadelphia Eagles are going to come on blitzes, but how about the Green Bay Packers? Al Harris comes on that first play from that side. They get that little push up the middle, get their hands up and deflect it. Cletus Hunt was the guy that deflected it.
Second down and 10. From the 24-yard line, McNabb. Off his best performance of the season last week. And a flag is thrown because Pinkston was held up by Al Harris. Al Harris, the former Eagle, and he and Pinkston matched up a lot on the practice field over the past couple of years. And the penalty is against Harris.
Yeah, and that's what Al Harris does so well, is that bump and run
pass
tight coverage.
31, defense, automatic first down, spot of the foul.
You know, and that's one thing you've always said you could do against these Eagle receivers. You can get up and you can rough them up. You can get up here and get very physical with them, hit them on the line of scrimmage, that they have a tough time getting away from bump coverage. And they do. But you don't have to hold them when you do it, as Al Harris just did.
First and 10 now for the Philadelphia Eagles at the 32-yard line. 4.5 minutes into the game on a chilly, wet night. From the 32, it is Buckhalter. Terrell Buckhalter, one of their three running backs, picks up five. Let's take a look at the Eagle offensive starters.
Donovan McNabb, Syracuse University.
Terrell Buckhalter, Nebraska.
John Ritchie, Stanford.
James Thrash, Missouri Southern.
Ty Pinkston, Southern Miss.
Chad Lewis, BYU.
Trey Thomas, you already know.
John Wellborn, Cal.
Hank Fraley, Robert Morris University.
Bobby Williams, Arkansas.
John Runyon, Michigan.
What's with these Florida State guys? Trey Thomas, you already know. Nobody mentions Florida State or the Seminoles. Second down and 4. And thrown down is Brian Westbrook, who was questionable coming into the game because of an ankle as to whether he would play or not. And Niall Diggs doesn't make that leg feel any better.
Yeah, one thing that helps is that your first layer is your defensive line. Now watch Aaron Kampman here. He's going to hold here. Now, as he holds this point, then your linebackers can come. See him? Hold, hold, hold here. Make them cut back and cut right into your pursuit.
Now it's third down and 3, and Deuce Staley is the running back in this set, and McNabb looks towards Staley, then looks again, then he's going to take off, and McNabb has a first down and considerably more across midfield to the Green Bay 44, something that McNabb has been doing less and less this year, but as you can see, when he does, occasionally it's with great effectiveness, 16-yard gain.
You know, one thing that Andy Reid was saying is it's built into their system. You know, people say that he doesn't run as much Don McNabb, but he said he has one read, two read, and on his third progression, if he doesn't have anyone, he runs. Now watch John Runyon here on Kabir Bajabiamila. I mean, that's what gave Don McNabb so much time at the start of it.
And then Chad Lewis with a nice block. McNabb slips after the fake and gets up and goes deep and into traffic. It is incomplete, intended for Pinkston, who is covered by Sharper. And let's take a look at the Packer defense.
Aaron Kampman, Iowa.
Gilbert Brown, Kansas.
Cletus
Hunt, Kentucky State.
Kabir Bajabiamila, San Diego State.
Hannibal Navies, Colorado.
Nick Barnett, Oregon State.
Niall Diggs, The Ohio State University.
Mike McKenzie, Memphis.
Antoine Edwards, Clemson.
Dadin Sharper, the College of William and Mary.
Al Harris, A&M Kingsville.
There is a flag down while we were rolling in the lineups.
We'll go back 5 yards.
That had to be an illegal substitution.
12 men in the huddle.
Yeah.
On the offense, 5 yard penalty. Second down.
See, even though it's a break, you can't put 12 men in the huddle because, you know, that's the thing years ago that we used to do. You'd put 12 or 13 guys in the huddle, break the huddle, two would run off, and they wouldn't know what you were playing. So the NFL and their rules make you declare by your huddle who is going to play in that play.
And that costs him 5 yards and makes it second down and 15 now at the 50-yard line. Philadelphia's opening possession. And now we have another flag. Bill Carollo, who refereed the Super Bowl last year, tells us.
False start, 87, offense, 5 yard penalty, second down.
Pinkston, so back to back penalties, and for Andy Reid's team, it's second down and 20 now.
You know, one thing they have on Andy Reid, and it's kind of all teams, if you throw on first down and you throw an incomplete pass, usually the second down is a running play. So the defense plays run in that second down. Now that's the situation now. Second down, but after two penalties, I'm not sure if you still play run if you're on defense or if you still run if you're the Eagles.
Second and 20 for Andy Reid's team. Reid, an assistant coach here under Mike Holmgren in the 90s. And McNabb gets taken down by Grady Jackson, who just joined the team from New Orleans, and Larry Smith. So the secondary did great work, and then McNabb got into a sandwich between those two for the sack.
You know, there's a lot of things going on here. First, they're going to get a good push right up here. This is the thing that Mike Sherman was talking about that he wanted. He said they weren't getting any push in the middle. Watch right there. They get the push in the middle by Smith and Grady Jackson. The other thing is, there was no one open. You know, we were talking about pass protection as part of it. The other thing is, the receivers have to get open when the quarterback's ready.
Great work in the secondary, and in third and 28, they'll give it to Deuce Staley. And Staley takes it up to the 47-yard line. So the two penalties and the sack put them in no man's land. Nick Barnett, the rookie out of Oregon State, makes the tackle. And now Philadelphia will punt about halfway through the opening period.
And these are the types of things that are tough to play on the road. You know you're going to have these things early in the game, and you have to just get through them, settle down, and play the game.
Dirk Johnson ready to kick to Antonio Chapman, who runs back both kickoffs and punts for the Green Bay Packers. And this kick is a low kick that will roll to a stop at the 18-yard line. And Brett Favre will take over for the second time tonight at that spot with 7:17 left in a scoreless first quarter. Had a 5-game losing streak in that division. It's still wide open. Here's Amon Green breaking tackles. First down and a lot more. And into Philadelphia territory where he loses the football. And the question is, was he down? And the official comes in and says, yes, he was down. And the play is whistled dead as Michael Lewis came in, but Green was already down. And, of course, with Amon Green, the one downside to him is fumbling.
They watch a reverse fake here. They fake the reverse. That holds the defense back there. That lets Amon Green get to the outside. Now, the thing we know about Amon Green, he always carries the ball in the left hand. The Philadelphia Eagles know about that, so that it's going to be open when he runs to the right, and they're going to be going after it.
Now Favre goes off his back foot, and the pass is incomplete, and then there's a flag down because Favre goes down. He gets picked up by Brandon Whiting, and Whiting trying to make nice, but Carollo was right there to say, uh-uh.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Number 98, defense, driving the quarterback into the ground. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Whiting tried to get away with it, but it's like, you know, knocking down a museum piece in the Louvre.
Yeah, and that's one thing you don't want to do. You don't want to make Brett Favre mad. I mean, after you have him here, you don't want to do that. You don't have to do that. You don't have to do it to Brett Favre. You don't have to do that to any quarterback in the league. And once you make contact, just let go. You don't have to drive him into the ground. That's a stupid penalty.
First and 10, the ball at the 36-yard line on the Packers' second possession of the game. Green again. Big hole right through the middle of that Philadelphia defense, and the ball is loose. The ball is loose, and it's recovered by Philadelphia. So again with Green, you get on one side of the action one of the best running backs in the league. On the other, you get this.
And we were just talking about that, and that's what Jim Johnson was talking about last night. He leaves it in his left hand, and he leaves it exposed, as he just did.
The 15 or more yards, tops in the league. The bad Amon Green. Six fumbles, tied with Tiki Barber of the Giants, who had a big one yesterday, a big fumble in their loss to Atlanta. Here it is, created by Seminole and recovered by Michael Lewis.
Yeah, he had it out there exposed, and part of it is you have to run with it. You have to pump your arms and run, but when you get hit, you would like to have the ball in front of you, not on your side.
And that came a play after the ball came loose when his elbow hit the ground. So at the 27-yard line, here is Buckhalter. Gain of three up to the 30-yard line. For Donovan McNabb, last year, you'll recall, he fractured his fibula in a game against Arizona. The irony is, in that game, and they didn't know he had fractured the fibula until he took x-rays after the game, he threw four touchdown passes on a fractured leg. That's as many touchdown passes as he has thrown all this season.
You know, I've always felt, and I don't know if there's anything to this, but when a guy has an injury, you know, like Brett Favre has it done, we just talked about Donovan McNabb, they seem or tend to concentrate more.
Second down and seven as he rolls and throws on the run, and that's caught by the tight end, Chad Lewis, and it's a first down up to the 43. And for Donovan McNabb, in recovering from that injury, which took place last November 17th in Philadelphia, and then a right thumb this year, hit it off a helmet in the Buffalo game, and then he got that right fibula contacted on the 5th of October. Last week, a back contusion. In fact, had x-rays after the game and x-rays again on Monday, but here he is.
And he said that fibula, when he took that hit there, he said that was swollen and bothered him for 3 weeks.
Quick throw here to Freddie Mitchell, who breaks the tackle, and Mitchell gets forced out of bounds close to the first down mark by Nile Diggs and in Green Bay territory.
Now, I was just going to say, that's an automatic. Freddie Mitchell is in the slot. Now, if you cover off, if you don't put a guy up on him, they just automatically take the ball, and McNabb just throws it right out to him. If you have a slot guy here and he's not covered, if you don't have a defender here, this is an automatic. Just pick it up and boom, just give it to him right now.
Got by Sharper. Now Buckhalter is the running back in this set. From the 47, Buckhalter. Harrell, for the moment, is the lead running back, but they really love Brian Westbrook, though he'll be limited tonight. Westbrook had emerged, then he got hurt. And remember, last year and in years past, it's been Deuce Staley, but Deuce was late in coming into camp, and here comes Deuce now, whose role is pretty much limited to third down situations.
I'll tell you what, I won't bet you, but I will bet you that before this year is over, Deuce Staley is going to be or play a pretty big part in it. That eventually, you know, the cold weather, you need to run, you got to bang it at him, Deuce will be that guy.
Here he is on first down for a change. And he's tackled at the line of scrimmage by Grady Jackson, just picked up from New Orleans. Take a look at how all three have done this season. Westbrook has really emerged, and of course it was his run back of a punt that beat the Giants, a 5.5-yard average. And then Buckhalter with a 4.3 average. He was hurt 2 years ago, otherwise he might have ascended to the top spot last year. And then there's Deuce, who's been fairly limited.
And, you know, by doing that, I mean, that, you know, using three guys, running back by committee and those types of things, no one really gets into a rhythm. I mean, they all go along with it, especially when they win, but I guarantee you, none of them like it.
Second down and 10 from the 45-yard line. Chase McNabb escapes and then throws it away. He was run down from behind by Nile Diggs, forcing McNabb to throw out of bounds, and it's third down and 10.
Hey, you see what they did on that way? They brought both inside linebackers, both of these guys, and they come across, so they're going to get penetration here. But the thing about McNabb is when he sees it and or feels it, he can get to the outside. See how they cross those linebackers? McNabb saw it and just ran to the outside. Now when you get out there, if you don't have anything open, you just throw it away.
Third and 10, scoreless first quarter. Philadelphia at the Green Bay 45-yard line. Three receivers set to the right. McNabb looks that way, then goes over the middle, and it's dropped. It's dropped by James Thrash. Mike McKenzie with the coverage, and the Eagles will punt.
And another blitz by the Green Bay Packers. You know, we talked about that third down, how they were the worst in the NFL, and I think they want to use more pressure now, and in doing more pressure, they're using more blitzes.
Johnson's first punt, 36 yards in the rain. And Antonio Chapman is back at his own 10-yard line. Floater. They let it go, and it bounced into the end zone. Back to the 20 will come far for the Packers with 3:13 left in the opening quarter. Philadelphia nothing, Green Bay nothing. The Green Bay Packers always playing to a full house. At the 20-yard line, first down. They come up in that power eye that they started the game with. The fake to Green, the roll by Favre, and then Brett throws incomplete. So Favre is outside the hash marks there, and he loves to go outside the hash marks, but what is really interesting is the direction he loves to go. And take a look at this. When he goes to the right of the hash marks, as he did there, 87.3, that's a great rating. When he throws between the hashes, that's pretty good too, 83.1. But when he rolls against the grain to his left, look at that, 138.6. Four touchdowns, no picks. So a guy who goes, as they say, against the grain has been fantastic going to his left.
I think he concentrates more, and as Mike Sherman said, he squares his shoulder more when he goes to his left.
Here's Green picking up four, and the ball is loose again. And Chad Clifton comes up with the ball. So Green tonight has now fumbled twice and had a near fumble on a play that the ball came out on when his elbow hit the turf.
I don't know if it's not that sleeve that he's wearing on his left arm, you know, because when you get slippery and everything, I don't know that it's not right there, that that is adding a slickness to that left arm, because it looks like the ball is just popping out of there way too easily. For his hustling offensive lineman.
And in the rain and in the cold and with the sleeve and with his history, it's an adventure every time he carries the football.
Third down. That sleeve looks slick.
It does, no question. Third and two, and the pass is caught by Javon Walker, who comes off a two-touchdown game. A flag is thrown at the end of the play. For the moment, it's a first down. Lito Shepard made the tackle. Bill Carollo tells us the penalty is against Green Bay, so no first down. Back it comes.
Javon Walker is a guy that Brett Favre starting to enjoy a little. He had a, what they call, a breakout game last week.
Pass interference, 87, offense, 10-yard penalty, replay third down.
Some guys have breakdowns and some guys have breakouts.
Well, he had a breakout, and David Martin at tight end had a breakdown, and probably what it was is a pick. You know, and any time you get that offensive pass interference, he's usually picking the guy that was supposed to be defending Javon Walker.
Third down and 12 now after the penalty. 2 minutes to go and a scoreless opening period. Walker out of Florida State, their first round pick last season. They toss it back to Tony Fisher. And the undrafted guy out of Notre Dame takes down the chain gang as he comes up a little short of the first down. Finally run down by the safety, Michael Lewis.
What do they do? They put two receivers out to one side, and they call that a toss crack. They're going to get the ball to the outside, and they crack down on the two inside defenders. Do they get two guys right here? Oops, this is the play before, and we're looking at David Martin. He's number 87, and you see that's what a pick is. See, he blocks the guy who was supposed to cover Javon Walker.
Josh Bidwell, a little high snap. He has to jump up to bring it down and gets the boot away. And a fair catch is called for by Reno Mahe at the 31-yard line. 1:26 left in the first period in Green Bay. No score on Monday Night Football.
Now there's some football fans.
And most of them have driven up from the Milwaukee area for this game. A whistle before the snap. The Packers play 8 regular season games here.
Prior to the snap, full start, 48.
He went, brother.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Fullback John Ritchie. When they took the games out of Milwaukee a few years ago, they used to play a couple of games per season at County Stadium. What they did is they allowed those people in Milwaukee to buy the tickets for 2 regular season games and 1 preseason game here in Green Bay. And tonight's a Milwaukee night. So 2 different sets of fans. So I'm sure there's a little bit of overlap as well. First and 15 from the 27-yard line. And Brian Westbrook picks up 1.5 yards.
Yeah, with both sets of fans, whether you're a Green Bay fan from Green Bay or a Green Bay fan from Milwaukee or a Green Bay fan from any place else, they know how to be pretty good fans in cold weather.
The whole state.
Well, that's Kabir Bajabiamila here. This is why you like speed at a defensive end. You know you can have speed at linebackers and secondary. When you have a guy that can chase down and run from the backside, that gives you an added tackler on a runaway.
2nd and 14 from the 28-yard line. The short drop by McNabb, a quick throw over the middle, and that's dropped, intended for the tight end Chad Lewis. How did Philly's script go tonight? Here's a peek, John.
You know, Andy Reid is always trying to be balanced, and he's trying to run more maybe than he used to. Look at that. He ran the ball 8 times, passed it 7 times, and the running has been pretty good, a 5.1 average.
You see 7 pass plays, 2 for 6, plus a sack that counts as a pass play. Well, turducken, it's November. Of course you smell turducken.
We're getting close to smelling it.
3rd and 14 from the 28-yard line. It's time a deep drive. And a deep throw and incomplete. Good coverage intended for James Thrash. 3 and out.
Don't you have a feeling that these defenses are much more aggressive than the offenses? That both defenses are going after the offenses. Here they're in a dime defense. And we talk about guys getting open or not getting open. You see Al Harris, number 31, had perfect coverage there.
Defense is aggressive. Offense is having trouble in the slick conditions. Dirk Johnson goes down, but there's no flag as he gets the kick away. And that will roll to a halt at about the 23-yard line. Tony Fisher came in and almost blocked it.
As we look at Brett Favre's thumb here, you see what they did is they made a soft cast. You can kind of see the line of it right there. They took some soft plastic, and then they melted. And then they kind of put it right on the thumb. Then they glued it. You see the cast is right there, the soft plastic. Then they glued that plastic to his thumb, and then they put tape around it. Now, as Brett says, here's the thing that bothers me most. The thumb right when the ball leaves my hand.
Ron Green, we talk about Favre and this record. Remember, Ron Jaworski held the record, 116 consecutive starts for a QB. Now it's 182 for Favre. What does that mean? That means Favre has started more than 4 seasons worth of games. It started in 1992, and who knows when it'll end. That's a warrior. End of the period, no score. Monday Night Football is back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Tonight's aerial coverage is brought to you by Bud Light, as you look down into Lambeau Field in Green Bay, Wisconsin, and we start the 2nd quarter. Al Michaels, John Madden, Lisa Guerrero. Light rain. So every time you shoot it like that, looking into the lights, it looks like a storm. But it's, and in the meantime, as John suggested, a new sleeve now for Amon Green. The slick black one is gone, and Green carries up to the 32-yard line to make a 3rd and about 1.5 yards.
Yeah, you could see that was a problem. And we talked to the Eagles. They know that. They know it's always in the left hand, so you know to go for it. And it just looked like it was kind of sliding out of there. It looked very slick. So in that last series, they took these things off. You can see they look slick. They look very shiny. They take them off, and they put these on. The old Amon Green, the current Amon Green.
Partner, that was a great catch. I mean, that was beautiful. You saw that right off the bat. Green makes the switch. And now Favre on the long count on third down and two out of the shotgun. Throws deep for Donald Driver, but the pass is incomplete. It kind of hung up in the wind, and Troy Vincent was there to cover on the play, and it's fourth down and two.
You know, Clinton Hart, the free safety, came on a blitz. We were talking about things that the Packers wanted to do against the blitz, and one was the long count so that he could see it. And Clinton Hart got up there, and he had to wait, and he had to wait, and he had to wait. Then he finally gets blocked so Brett Favre can get rid of the ball.
Now as Bidwell gets ready to punt, the Packers are saying the Eagles came across the line first. If so, that would be a first down. It's a third and two.
And these fans realize, Al, what you just said.
Yes, and it is a first down.
You know, that's what had been killing the Packers earlier, is the fumbles and the penalties.
Defense, right defensive end, attempting to draw the offense into a false start. 5-yard penalty, first down.
I think they call it right here on Ike Reese. Now, watch here. He's going to try. You see, he moves there. I don't know that he tried to draw him off sides. It looked like he was just going, and he got in that neutral zone. Now, if he gets back, it's not okay anymore if it makes the offensive guy move.
But they call it on him. That's a first down against that special teams maven. Fifth penalty on Philadelphia in the period. And that Bubba Franks makes the catch. It's a short gain. Brett Favre in the first period tonight threw only two passes. He was one of two, and that's the fewest he has thrown in any first quarter since the third game of this consecutive game streak back in 1992, when he was just a pup under Mike Holmgren. Is Green, and he picks up the first down, and there's a flag down, a flag thrown in the secondary.
Yeah, and I think part of it is we're talking to, you know, to Brett Favre about how he likes Amon Green, get the running game established. Yeah, and he hasn't gotten that established, so then he can't do the things off it, like play action pass or bootlegs and those things, because every time they get a play, then they either fumble or they have a penalty.
Holding 89 offense, 10-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
Penalty on Robert Ferguson.
Robert Ferguson, a wide receiver, and more and more, if you're going to make a big play in a running game, your wide receivers have to block. And the problem is they get out there on those corners and they have to hold the block. So sometimes in holding the block, they hold the guy.
Ferguson, a big penalty last week in the Minnesota game. Part of an illegal formation call that cost them a touchdown. Second down and eight from the 39-yard line. Blitz comes. Screen is set up, but the Eagles play it perfectly and break it up. And it's incomplete. Third down and long.
Hey, you just feel that the pack, well, neither offense has gotten in any sync. But these guys throw more screen passes. And in fact, Steve Hurd had that stat that 22% of the time the Green Bay Packers throw a screen pass. They throw something behind the line of scrimmage. So now the defenses know that. Nate Wayne was right there and just waiting for that screen pass.
Now Green goes to the bench on third down and eight. Favre is out of the shotgun. Tony Fisher flanks him. Eagles with a five-man rush, and Favre with the arm coming forward has the ball slip out, and it is covered up by Tauscher, the tackle. Mark Tauscher covers up.
Tauscher recovered.
And again, with Brett Favre, with the thumb, with the slick ball, with the condition and all, this is the second time this has happened tonight.
Yeah, between Amon Green and Brett Favre, this is about the fourth or fifth time that they've fumbled. In fact, I think so far in every drive, the Packers have had a fumble.
And that was a fumble, not an incomplete pass. Punt is taken in by Reno Mahe at the 28-yard line. So at 12:35 to go, we're still scoreless in Green Bay on Monday Night Football. We'll see. after he'd come into the game with none all season. Green Bay's fumbled the ball four times, lost one. The game is scoreless. Philadelphia has it at its own 28. Buckhalter is the running back as we get ready for their first play. And McNabb off the play fake, throws to the outside, caught by the fullback John Ritchie to the 34-yard line. He's tackled there by McKenzie.
John Ritchie on the reception.
Take a look at this. When Andy Reid scores first, he's 27-8. Nobody's been better among active coaches in scoring first than Mike Sherman, who took over here in 2000. He's 25-5 when he can get on the board first. And right now the game is scoreless. And there is the 48-year-old purposeful New Englander. And there is Andy Reid at age 45 in his fifth year as the head coach of Philadelphia. Second down and four. And they're going to try to work a double reverse, and instead it's Todd Pinkston juggling it, has to hold on, and is taken down at the 23. And I don't know that you pull that play off on a night like this, John.
I don't think so. I mean, they're all having a tough time handling the ball tonight, and on a double reverse, you have to hand it off a couple of times. I think Todd Pinkston was very smart here in not handling it off. See, he's handling it there. He never really did have control when he was supposed to hand it off. So he did the smart thing right here and just kept it, got both hands around it, and went down with it.
Better an 11-yard loss than a turnover, and it's third down and 15 from the 23-yard line. Pressure on, chased by a pair of Packers, and the throw is low. Baja Biamila and Juki Wakari were chasing him, and it's fourth and 15, and in comes the punting unit.
You know, because of that second down that put the Eagles in third and long, then it was a little easier for the Green Bay Packers to play this third down defense. But again, they used their stunning to get speed coming up the middle. That's where they weren't getting the push in the middle. So you can get some new guys in the middle or bring your fast defensive ends in the middle.
Dirk Johnson, a low punt, bounces at the 50, and then rolls sideways and stops at the 46-yard line. So neither team can really get anything going. 31-yard punt. Green Bay has the ball. No score. 10:54 to the half. And Slick, it's been loose tonight a lot. Four fumbles, and they try to keep it dry in a number of ways. Shoes as well.
That's the way you dry out shoes, but the big key is the officials keeping the footballs dry, and they don't look like they're keeping them very dry tonight.
And first down, it's Green covering up to the 49-yard line. Mike Holmgren came here, and there he is in the middle. Mike, of course, in Seattle now. And what a staff he was able to put together through the years. I mean, John Gruden was here, and so was Steve Mariucci. Andy Reid coached under Holmgren. Dick Girard, coach of the Chicago Bears, was here as well. And then a little later on, Mike Sherman came aboard, and then Sherman went with him to Seattle. Reid got the job in Philadelphia. And here they are matched up on Monday night. Second down and seven as the ball is handed to Amon Green, and he plugs his way for a first down, carrying Eagles with him all the way to the 41-yard line. Of Eagles.
Now that is what you call power running. I mean, you just get down and you just get your shoulders down and you keep your feet and your legs moving. Watch, they're always going to pull a guard, usually coming this way, a guard and a lead back. They like, see, here's Marco Rivera. He hits right there, and then they have the lead. They always have a lineman pulling and either a fullback or tight end leading. And that combination is in front of Amon Green.
Almost unnoticed, that's already 95 rushing yards for Green, and it's caught by Donald Driver. And that's what happens when you fumble the ball twice and you have another near fumble. You kind of lose sight of what a guy is doing with 12 carries for 95 yards already for that man.
Look at that. His average is 7.9. He came into this game averaging 5.1. So that's been the key to the success of this offense. And once they can get that going and get him going, then Brett Favre can do his pass running game off that.
Second down and four at the 36. Najee Davenport is the running back, and the former Miami Hurricane fullback picks up about three to the 33. And Carlos Emmons makes the tackle.
Third and two.
Third and a deuce.
There's been so many of those coaches that have been here and gone on. We're talking to Brett Favre about playing against Andy Reid. He says, you know, it seems like every week I play against some guy that used to coach me.
And he's done very well against just about all of them. Next week, he sees Gruden again as they go to Tampa Bay, and this is Green picking up the first down. So they have now penetrated inside the Philadelphia 30, first down.
Yeah, first down, first time. I think these fans know that. Okay, now we're getting something. Now we're getting a little rhythm here. Now we're starting to get some first downs. They do an interesting thing here. They bring in Kevin Berry, who is an extra tackle. Now, a lot of times you'll do that on short yardage, goal line. But this is a first down play. And they bring in Kevin Berry, an extra tackle, as a tight end. So they have three tackles in the game.
From the 28, Green. Picks up a couple. You look at the numbers for Green Bay, and of course a lot of it is dictated by the weather, but Green Bay has rushed for 121 yards, and in passing they are minus six. And the reason is, I mean, Favre has actually thrown for 18 yards, but the sacks have cost them 24. That counts on the passing side as Green goes over 100.
Well, you know, you don't get the feeling that Brett Favre or Mike Sherman or Tom Rossley are too interested in passing right now.
Second and seven, and Favre gets almost sacked and then finally sacked because Nate Wayne came in and got an arm around his neck, and then Michael Lewis said, I'll finish this one off.
Isn't there a saying, like, always on Monday night? Said Nate Wayne. Every time Nate Wayne plays in a Monday night game, he makes big plays. He has a big game. He's all the way to the left. He's going to come from the outside. And you see him hold it back here, hold it back, hold it back here. So they don't count him. Then he comes free. You see, if he's up on or close to the line, they count him. They have to block him. If he's back off that far, they don't count him.
If Wayne could only play on Monday night, he'd been in Canton. He has six takeaways in his last six games on Monday night and 2.5 sacks as well. And now Favre throws and has it intercepted by, guess who? Nate Wayne. And then Favre is the man who makes the tackle at the 34-yard line. Well, Billy Crystal did a show called or a movie, Mr. Saturday Night. There's Mr. Monday Night.
Yeah, every time we see him, I mean, he does the thing. We see him. The play before that, he gets the big blitz, he gets the rush, he gets the sack, and right here, you're going to see him get the interception. See, again, they're getting pressure from this side. Nate Wayne was just in the middle, reading, playing that spy position, and he made a one-handed catch. That is a heck of a catch, too. I mean, a great interception, good coverage, good read, doing all those things, but one heck of a catch, and look who has to make the tackle. I say he had to make the tackle. That would have been a touchdown.
At the 34 now, Philadelphia has turned it on a dime in this scoreless first half. McNabb is flushed out, directing traffic downfield, and the pass is thrown out of bounds at the 12-yard line. James Thrash was the nearest receiver, second and 10.
Don't you get the feeling that these wide receivers of Philadelphia never get any separation?
Absolutely. Thrash and Pinkston in particular.
It seems like there's always someone that just blanketed right to him. That time what the Packers are doing is they're starting to get that pressure up the middle. And what that is doing is that's forcing Donovan McNabb to run out to his right. And then the receiver on his right isn't getting open. Someone has to help him.
Ongoing problem in Philadelphia. They have only one touchdown pass to a wide receiver this season. Last week, Freddie Mitchell, and Carell Buckholder is taken down by Hannibal Navies.
Navies played that one perfectly. He was what they call the capper, the guy right on the run, the inside guy. They had it contained, had to make the cutback, and Hannibal Navies was right up in the face.
The irony there is that when they let Wayne go to Philadelphia, Navies is the guy who took his spot at outside linebacker.
And you'll see he plays here. You see he plays from the inside. They have the outside contained so that there's no cutback, and when they cut back, they cut right back into Navies.
And we have an injured Packer. I noticed that Darren Sharper was limping. And they work on him right there. It is Darren Sharper. Injury timeout. Long way. assist in Green Bay. Darren Sharper came out of the game, but there are six DBs in there right now, and Buckhalter goes through the line and takes the ball to the 30-yard line, and beyond as Marcus Anderson makes the tackle.
And I think that took him into field goal position. That was a pretty good play. I mean, they get third and long, so they run that draw. They weren't in field goal position, but by gaining that yardage, they got into field goal position.
So now David Akers, one of the best in the league, will attempt this field goal from 47 yards out. Coy Detmer to hold, Mike Bartram to snap in these frosty and slick conditions. And Akers' kick is no good. Just missing. And Green Bay gets into the 37, so they cannot cash in on the interception. Just missed. AFC East leading Patriots, as after the missed field goal and the missed opportunity by Philadelphia after their second turnover, Green picks up a couple up to the 40-yard line.
Yeah, we're talking about neither one of these offenses being very aggressive and these defenses being very aggressive. You kind of get the idea that in this first half, they're just kind of sparring. You know, the offenses don't want to be the one to make a mistake, although they have been making mistakes. The other team hasn't been able to capitalize on it.
And neither team has really had any penetration to speak of. We've had only that one field goal attempt from 47 yards as Green takes it to the 43-yard line. Funny thing on that field goal, I mean, Akers had the distance and it just missed going outside the upright. And the funny thing was the back judge looked up at the upright and then looked over to the other guy as if the other guy was supposed to tell him. You've got the back judge and the field judge there. And Akers just missed under the back judge's side.
Right, and that's why you put one official under both bars, and they each have that side, and the official of that side looked to the other guy, because I was watching him to see what he was going to signal, and he signaled nothing.
Third down and five, Eagles showing blitz. Here they come from the right side, and Favre throws that way. Into the flat, Wesley Walls, picked up at the beginning of the season, gets tackled by the unheralded Michael Lewis. And talking to Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator, last night, I said, who's been your best player? He said, Michael Lewis. He said, Mark Simoneau's done a tremendous job, but Simoneau comes in and out on certain situations, he says, but day-to-day, game-to-game, that's the man right there.
Yeah, and he's kind of held things together back there with Brian Dawkins being out. I mean, Brian Dawkins is the other safety who's been injured, the free safety, who is one of the best in all of football.
Bidwell's kick is a beauty, fielded at the 6-yard line by Reno Mahe, and Mahe up past the 20 to the 21-yard line.
When you field it at the 6, you better get it past the 20.
Absolutely. 51-yard boot. Donovan McNabb, and he was under fire early this season after the way Philadelphia started. And here's what he told Lisa about dealing with that earlier this year.
I sat down with my two dogs, and, you know, we sort of had a heart-to-heart. Looked in their eyes and they looked in mine and they told me everything was gonna be fine. Sort of like the Scooby-Doo movie. I mean, you know, it was just an opportunity for me to just, you know, go home and sort of just refresh, you know, just kind of just throw everything out of my mind and just focus on the positive things.
Well, he sits down with man's best friend. Why not?
Two of them.
Carell Buckle, but for tonight it's been a three-dog night.
Yeah, and then, you know, he's looking into four eyes, too.
Well, for McNabb and the Eagles, you know, you look at this team for the last 2 years, they've been to the NFC Championship game. So you get to that point and the expectations are so high. But then the way they start the season, you have to give Reed and this group a lot of credit for coming back, winning 5 out of 6. And as I said, at the open, doing it fairly quietly.
Yeah, and the thing is Donovan McNabb was just saying there that you don't like to have a bye after 2 games, but after 2 games like they played, a bye was really what they needed. And they just kind of got away from it all, and they didn't really have a good training camp. They didn't have a good preseason. They didn't have a beginning. So they got away, came back, and started all over again.
And beat, at that time, a pretty hot Buffalo team to get it started. So we come to the two-minute warning in icy and rainy Green Bay. Nothing. Himself in the past. He's imitating Keith Jackson. He's got Keith Jackson talking to Keith Jackson going off the field.
Right, and if you know Brett Favre, you can believe it. And, we talk about, pros and how much money they make, but it's still a game. It's still about having fun. And Brett Favre, I think, has more fun than anyone that plays it.
No doubt. I wonder if he calls his linemen the Big Uglies. Third and two. And Green Bay with a big stop. Lyle Diggs meets Correll Buckhalter head-on, forcing the punt.
This first half has been a defensive battle, hasn't it? I mean, both of these defenses are playing up tight to the line of scrimmage. Both of them are blitzing a lot. Both of them are bringing defensive backs up. They're doing everything they can, like they did on that last play, to stop the run. And somewhere, to loosen that up, you're going to have to be able to throw the ball.
Green Bay takes a timeout to conserve the clock. They'll get the ball back, and we can tell you that Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Friendly nonstop service all across the country. Southwest Airlines, a symbol of freedom. T-Mobile, get more minutes, more features, more service. State Farm, like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And Bud Light, for the great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down, make it a Bud Light.
Well, so far, every time the Eagles have punted, the Packers have come on a punt block.
This time he gets the kick away easily, does Burke Johnson, but it's not a good kick, and it rolls out of bounds at the 46-yard line. Make it the 45 is where they will spot it. And two timeouts remaining for Green Bay. This is the 231st game ever played in this facility, and the only time these fans and the ones before them have seen a scoreless first half, you'd have to go back 23 years to 1980. As Favre tries to put at least three on the board, he begins this drive with a handoff to Green for a gain of four.
I'm on Green, the ball carrier.
And again, I know that you have to be able to run, you have to be able to stop the run, but somewhere the passing game is going to have to play a part in this game. Now, I know the balls are wet, they're slick out there, and maybe it is tough to handle, but the team that does it is going to win this game.
Second and seven, he's going to air it out, and it is off the fingertips of Donald Driver. He threw long to Driver before, and the ball hung up in the wind, and this time off the fingertips of Driver to make it third down and seven.
Brett Favre has a lot of confidence in Donald Driver, and you're going to see he's in, even in a form of double coverage. So he has a bump there. He has a safety over the top deep. He outruns both of them. I mean, you have to catch that pass. I mean, I think that all the any time you throw a pass, the receiver has to catch it. I think you can't blame the quarterback and say he had to put it out a little further, a little left. You have to put it on the receiver. When it gets like that, he has to make the cut.
Brett Favre with a pass rating of 12. Not a typo. Third and seven. That rating will go up a little bit. Here is Antonio Freeman. The once and present Packer makes the catch. Antonio left here, went to Philadelphia. Then they brought him back. It's a 15-yard gain. Under a minute to play and two timeouts. First down at the 36-yard line. And Favre hands the ball to Green with a big opening. And Green picks up a first down as he gets the ball inside the 25-yard line. And now Green Bay will take its second timeout. So the Packers on the move at the end of the first half.
Yeah.
By Bud Light. You can see the low clouds hovering over Lambeau Field. Light rain throughout the game. Temperature in the mid-30s now going down. And at Lambeau Field, well, too late.
They're caught in mid-movement there.
First down at the 24-yard line. One timeout remaining for the Packers. Favre sets up the screen to Green. Has some blocking inside the 20, inside the 10, all the way to the end zone for the touchdown. For Green, that's four straight games with a touchdown catch.
perfect call for that defense. They came to a blitz on that side. They threw the screen right to the side of the blitz. Then if you get by that first guy, you got an open lane to the goal line.
Amon Green, who has already rushed for 122 yards, gets it into the end zone. There are flags down as Longwell booted the extra point.
You know, and the Packers run more screens than anyone in football. And it's closer, you get closer to the goal line, you know that the Eagles are going to blitz you a lot. So they anticipated blitz, and they threw the screen to the side of the blitz.
Eagles, 12 men on defense, 5-yard penalty, it'll be assessed on the kickoff. The extra point is good.
7-0 Green Bay.
Watch what happens. Here's Amon Green. The screen is going to be out to this side. The blitz is coming from this side. Once he gets by it, look what he has out here. He sneaks off to the right. Here comes a blitz. He fakes like he's going to block it. Let those guys come through. Invite them through. Get behind your lineman. Good block by Marco Rivera there. And then he makes one or two moves, and he's in the end zone.
Safety Michael Lewis blitzing Favre, giving Green pretty much a free ride to the end zone.
Well, that's what Mike Sherman was saying last night. He said, we would like to run our screen at the side they blitz from, and we would like to run the ball at their blitzes and not away from them. Well, there's a lot of yes down there, isn't there?
A lot of yes when you score with 40 seconds left. Green with a souvenir. Favre has now thrown a touchdown pass in 18 straight games, equaling his career high. A long way from the NFL record, the untouchable mark of 47 by Johnny Unitas.
Look at Amon Green, though, 6.8 yards per carry. And as a receiver, I mean, he's Brett Favre, of course, he's his favorite ball carrier, but he's also his favorite receiver.
Longwell's kickoff, fielded by James Thrash at the 10. Brings it back up to about the 28-yard line. And a little extra action taking place with 35 seconds remaining in the half. Favre looking up and savoring the touchdown pass as they show the replay on the big board.
You know, we saw that graphic where either one of these coaches, when they get the lead, they usually win the game. And I think both of them know that, you know, and I've always said the toughest points to get in any game are the first one. Andy Reid had a chance at the first ones. They missed the field goal, and then the Packers get the ball. They get a good drive for a screen pass for a touchdown, get the first one.
And Andy Reid knows that his team has failed on two turnover opportunities to cash in. They give the ball to Deuce Staley. Up to the 35-yard line he goes. And Philadelphia, with that play and not calling a timeout, apparently will be very content to be down by 7 and go to the locker room and regroup.
I think with the conditions on the field and the conditions of the football and so on and what's happened, I think this is a smart move. You're only down by 7. There's still a half of football to be played. As you said, go in, regroup, talk about it, come out, start the second half.
End of the first half. The Green Bay Packers 7. The Philadelphia Eagles nothing. The Toyota Halftime Show coming up next when we come back after this message from the National Football League and a word from our ABC stations. After the Green Bay Packers scored the only touchdown of the first half, lead 7-0. Let's check in with Lisa.
I talked to Mike Sherman at halftime. He said that he was very frustrated with the turnovers. He said certainly the slick ball and the wet grass are a factor tonight, and he did make a bold prediction. He said, Lisa, whoever can hang on to the ball is the team that's going to win this game tonight. It may seem obvious, but he stressed that very clearly.
Well, that's a man who has watched his team fumble the ball 4 times in the first half. He was fortunate they lost it only once. The kick is fielded by James Thrash at the 12-yard line. Thrash up past the 40, and he's out of bounds at midfield. So a good run back, and Philadelphia will have nice field position to start the third quarter. Numbers through the first half. And what's fascinating is in passing yards, the Packers with only 21, they were in minus figures prior to that screen pass to Green.
Yeah, and the big pass that the Packers had, though, I thought was that third down pass to Antonio Freeman. That got him the first down, put him in position to run that screen pass to Amon Green.
Freeman coming over from Philadelphia after spending the first part of his career right here in Green Bay. And now McNabb, whose passing game has had 20 yards tonight, gives it to Deuce Staley, and he is down for a loss of one. Cletus Hunt stops him behind the line.
And if you look at Donovan McNabb's passing chart, you can see what he's done in the first half, and will also tell you what he has to do in the second half. You look, under 5 yards, he's 2 for 2. Over 5 yards, he's only completed one pass over 5 yards. None here, only one there. So somewhere he has to get some guys open and complete some passes past 5 yards.
Second and 10. That's a short pass. It's caught by Thrash, but it's a small gain. Nile Diggs makes the tackle up at the 49-yard line, a pickup of only 4.
I said he only completed one over 5 yards. He only completed 2 under 5 yards, so maybe just a completed pass by this Eagle offense would be something to get him started.
McNabb is 4 of 12 to 32 yards. And the Eagles, as you can see on third down, have had almost 13 yards to go on average. Here it's third down and 6. And it's a little swing pass caught by Deuce Staley, and a first down inside the 40, banging off Packers, and finally run out of bounds by McKenzie inside the 20-yard line to the 17.
That was a perfect call for the situation. They were in 6 defensive backs, the Packers were, and they came on a blitz, so they got them in man coverage. This is exactly what you want. You see they have 6 defensive backs in here. Here you see the blitz coming. They just get it to the outside to Deuce Staley. He just has to beat one man, and then he's off to the races. Beat one or run over one, get on the sidelines until you get knocked out of bounds.
Swing pass to Deuce Staley, more than doubling McNabb's passing total. Good for 34 yards at the 17-yard line now. The handoff goes to Brian Westbrook, who's been limited tonight. He has the pimpy ankle, and he picks up a couple, and he's tackled by Nile Diggs.
You see old Hank Fraley down there on that thing flopping around?
Center.
That's what those centers do. He has his work cut out for him tonight because the Packers have Gilbert Brown playing inside, and we talked about Grady Jackson, who they just picked up. Grady Jackson weighs 370 pounds. Big Gilbert's about 330. So you talk about a guy that has to block some loads in there. That's old Hank Fraley. And here's Grady Jackson, the load I was just talking about, right on his nose.
On second down and 8, McNabb in the pocket, throws, caught 12-yard line. Lino Mahe coming out of the backfield, and he is taken down at the 10 by Nick Barnett. That sets up a third down and 2.
Yeah, and that's probably what Andy Reid talked about in there at halftime. You know, okay, we have to start just running some straight at him. We don't need any of those double reverses, any tricks. Let's just run it and drop back and throw it. Got that sheet there. I mean, he has 2 sheets. He got one in his left hand and one in his right hand. Man, if you can't find a play out of that, you can't find a play.
Third down, short 3 at the 10-yard line. Opening drive of the second half. Tosses it back to Westbrook, and Westbrook is able to fight his way past the tackle and should have the first down. The head linesman will spot it at the 7-yard line, and that's going to set up a first down and goal.
Now that was a real power play there. They had a power strong right formation, and plus they get a man in motion, so they get an extra blocker. You see, they have the 2 tight ends plus the extra blocker, John Ritchie, who came in motion. So they really did power that right side. Instead of going up the middle or off tackle, they took their linemen, their tight ends, put them on the outside, and ran the perimeter.
They'll measure. Looks to me like it's a first down.
Me too.
We don't lie.
Especially after you see it and see the guy pointing you there. I do that one all the time.
No problem.
Do we have fog setting in now, or is it just tougher to see Andy Reid than it was in the first half?
I think a little fog. Its temperature is dropping, still raining lightly.
Some people say if the temperature drops, we may get snow.
First down and goal at the 7-yard line. Here's Westbrook swinging to the outside and wrapped up by Miles Diggs. Great play by Diggs to send him down back at the 13.
You know what Diggs did is he comes through there. They start that zone play where you take your offensive line and you just move everyone to the left. Watch, they all come here, all come here, all come here. And Diggs is just going to run right through it. But watch this zone blocking. Here, here, here. And there goes Diggs just running right through it.
Loss of six, second and goal. Deuce Staley is the running back in this set. Little roll by McNabb, and then it's dropped at the 10-yard line by the tight end L.J. Smith, the rookie from Rutgers, who dropped a sure touchdown pass in his debut against Tampa Bay on opening night on Monday Night Football, but had six catches last week against Atlanta.
Yeah, and they really like him, and they drafted him, you know, to be that wide receiver, tight end type of guy. I mean, the tight end that you can split out, that you can do things with, can be the second tight end, your pass receiving guy. And then, as you said, he dropped that big one in the open and just dropped one there.
Third down and goal now from the 13-yard line. McNabb throws, caught on a slant by Pinkston, but he's tackled at the 3-yard line, so Philadelphia is going to have to settle for an Akers field goal attempt as Al Harris was able to tackle him. So a short field goal attempt coming up for Akers to try to make it a 4-point game.
But I'll tell you what they did is the Eagle offense got some confidence on this drive. Here's Pinkston out here, here's Al Harris, and you're going to see him come in and run the slant. He starts upfield, gets Harris to turn his hip, and then he goes inside. But I think that drive right there, Al, was a confidence builder for the Eagle offense.
And helping to set it up was Thrash's good run back of the kickoff. 21-yard attempt is good. Philly gets on the board. 9:29 left in the third. 7-3 Green Bay. Threatening to wrap with 50 Cent, but we're going on the road, John. It's 49 Cent pretty soon.
Do you have those moves yet that you do with your hands when you rap? Yeah. If you have those down?
I'm trying.
I don't think you have them down, though.
Not yet. Philadelphia with Akers, including a bouncing ball that does get into the end zone. So Akers sent it on the grass for the last 35 or so yards. And it works out with 9:29 remaining in the third quarter. So the defense coming back on the field with Green Bay up 7-3. Night after tomorrow, Wednesday night, at 10 Eastern and Pacific and 9 Central, you'll see Karen Sisko following The Bachelor right here on ABC Wednesday night. Temperature in the upper 30s in Green Bay. Light rain throughout the night. Green Bay has it for the first time from the 20-yard line. They begin their first drive. Green picking up three.
You know, Amon Green, now that he got those sleeves off, looks a lot more confident, doesn't he? Remember, early in the game, you can see that he had the ball out there, and he had those elbow pads on that looked awfully slick. You see him right there, and you knew that that was a problem, so they changed him. Then he went to the new elbow pads. It's still Amon Green inside him, though, and he's making some big plays.
He's all right.
He's already rushed for 123 yards, and he's caught that one pass for 18.
Amon Green is 4 yards away from reaching 1,000 for the season. He's second in the league in rushing to Baltimore's Jamal Lewis, who has more than 1,100. But Green tonight with 126, and on second down and 6 from the 24-yard line. Throwing for Green, but a nice play made by Carlos Emmons to stop him at the 25. And let's check in with Lisa.
Well, Al, diamonds may be a girl's best friend, but Amon Green prefers emeralds. He had 15 of these emerald rings made up for the entire offensive unit in appreciation for his back-to-back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons. Now, on one side of the ring, he's got the player's name and his number. The other side of the ring is a quote from Walter Payton. Tough times go away. Tough people do not. At the top of the ring, there is a Batman logo. He loves Batman because he says he's a superhero with no superpowers. He's successful because of diligence, hard work, and heart.
And on third down and four with Fisher, spelling Green, Favre is going to run for a first down and runs out of bounds at the 33-yard line. And Brett Favre coming into the game this season and carried the ball seven times for 0 yards.
Right, you know, we were talking to Jim Johnson last night, the defensive coordinator of the Eagles. He said, one thing I've noticed about old Brett, that he doesn't run anymore. But you see, here's where he was trying to go. He was trying to throw out to the right. And you see, he has nothing there. So then he's looking out to that side. So then he escapes to the right, still has nothing there, sees that he can get a first down and takes it.
At the 33-yard line, Manje Davenport is the tailback. He gets the toss. Gets around the corner. Turns it into about a 7-yard pickup.
Yeah, if you're a fullback, though, like Manje Davenport, at some point you have to turn the ball upfield. At some point, you just can't run out of bounds. Now, I know that that's acceptable. I mean, these guys have run 30, 35 times, okay. But if you're just going to get two or three or four or five carries, when you get to that sideline, within 2 yards of it, you better turn up a bullet and maybe even get a first down.
Second and four. Amon Green is back in the game. Green. And Green will go to 1,000 yards for the season on that one, up to the 46-yard line. And he is closing in on one of the most venerable team records ever. Jim Taylor still holds the Green Bay team record for most yards in a season. It's lasted more than 40 years. And Jim Taylor, of course, and the acknowledgement in the Ring of Honor here, one of the all-time greats. He and Paul Hornung, the embodiment of Lombardi's Packers in many ways, at least out of the backfield. Here is Green again to the 50-yard line.
You know, and a lot of it is Amon Green, but a big part of it is that offensive line. And you take the center, Mike Flanagan, is having a Pro Bowl year. Mike Wall, who made the block on the play just before this, is Marco Rivera. We've shown him a number of times. Chad Clifton and Mark Tasher coming back from injuries a year ago. This is a very solid unit and a very strong blocking unit, especially the inside, especially these three guys in the middle.
Second and five. Ball is given to Najee Davenport. He gets pushed back, but forward progress may have netted him the first down as he got across the 45-yard line, and that will be a first down.
I was talking about Mike Wall and Mike Flanagan and Marco Rivera, the center and the two guards. The thing that the middle guys have to do is you have to get the guys blocked in front of you and then get up to that second level, get those guys. And that's what brings about big run. You know, the linemen block the first level, then get off those blocks. Now watch right there and right there and get up to the second level. The second level being linebackers or safeties who come down in the box.
Davenport again, and he loses the football. The fifth Green Bay fumble, but the fourth one they recover as Robert Ferguson saves the day at the 26-yard line.
I would think that Davenport would take his sleeves off now. These guys look like they got more stuff hanging off their bodies and on the ball than they really need. And again, you see right there, you have to get the ball in front of you. You see, at that point where you have to protect it, the ball should be in front of you. It was at Davenport's outside, and that's why and how it got knocked out.
Michael Lewis forced the fumble, but to no avail as a first down at the 26-yard line on a drive that began at the Green Bay 20. Now it's Green.
The Packers are just running the ball down their throats on this drive. As you were saying, they've run eight times and just passed once.
And then hard hit by Michael Lewis to stop him.
I was just saying, you were talking about the offensive line, and at some point you just let your offensive line take over. And at this is a point in this game that the Packers are letting their offensive line take over dominate the line of scrimmage and just hand the ball to either Amon Green, Davenport, or whoever's in there.
Second down and five at the 21-yard line. Green. In a way, when you look at the Packers tonight, John, with 141 rushing yards in the first half, 189 total, 23 passing. When you play in this climate, you build your team for this climate, and tonight is the ultimate manifestation of it.
Yeah, and that's exactly what the Green Bay Packers are. I mean, they're a team that is built to play on grass, outdoors, late in the season, in cold weather. And if you're going to do those things, then you better be able to run the ball.
On the other side of the coin, you wouldn't put the St. Louis Rams roster into Green Bay. I mean, you just wouldn't build a team that way for Lambeau Field.
Right, it's just the opposite. I mean, that is a team that is built to play indoors on turf.
Third down and six, and it's smelled out brilliantly by Ike Reese, who is there almost before the handoff. Great play, and that makes what would have been a field goal that almost would have been certain, just one that's a little questionable under these conditions.
Yeah, Ike Reese is right here. He's the nickel linebacker, excuse me, right here. He's the nickel linebacker, and you see him. He just comes on a run blitz. They're running a draw, and they run it right into Ike Reese.
So now a 45-yard field goal for Ryan Longwell, who is pitching a perfect season. Hasn't missed a field goal attempt, hasn't missed an extra point attempt all year. And for the first time, he misses one. Ryan Longwell, for the first time all season, on one straight and true, is just that much short. 7-3 Green Bay. 7 Central and Mountain from the 35-yard line. Here is Deuce Staley beginning the next Philadelphia drive up to the 46-yard line after Longwell missed for the first time this season. And take a look at this. In their last three games, games in which the Eagles have come up winners, they have trailed in each of them by 3 points in the second half against both New York teams and then last week Atlanta. And here they are again in that spot.
Now, don't you feel that Andy Reid has a lot to do with that, that he just has a calmness about him and an authority about him that tells everyone, just hang in there, we're going to be okay.
Always. Almost unflappable. And that is caught by Freddie Solomon. And before short, Mitchell, I'm sorry, Freddie Solomon, where am I coming from here? Freddie Mitchell for a gain of 9 up to the 45-yard line. Well, Solomon used to wear 84, too.
Yeah, Freddie Solomon, quarterback, wide receiver.
Monday Night Football brought to you by Microsoft, your potential, our passion. Hummer, check out the H2 at your local dealer. Hummer, like nothing else. Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. BU, nothing's better, Dr. Pepper. And Verizon Wireless, we never stop working for you.
And you know what they were doing there, making there, don't you? That's the biggest sauerkraut factory in the country.
Up here?
Yeah. They know how to make sauerkraut. You see what it goes through?
Sauerkraut, brats, Deuce Staley. There it is. And I'm being told there is more sauerkraut made here than is made in the entire country of Germany.
I'll guarantee you, when you've got two guys with pitchforks, that has to be true. Look at that. That's going to be in a jar someplace. So if someone's pulling out some kraut, it's just gone through the pitchfork.
The guy was standing in it. Devoured by it.
That's the kraut you had for dinner last night.
Not me. Third down and two from the 45-yard line. Roll by McNabb, and the pass is incomplete. And the Packers, with Barnett knocking it away from L.J. Smith. And good coverage, legal coverage.
You know, and I think that's been the thing with all the Eagle receivers all the time. There's always good coverage on them. I said that earlier. You don't see a lot of separation. You don't get guys open, but this is what Donovan McNabb always seems to be looking at. You know, I mean, something, there's no place to throw the ball.
Dirk Johnson to punt. Sending it into the night. Rain, it bounces at the 3 and into the end zone. Sean Morey could not stop it before it got to the goal line. 2 seconds remaining in the period. 7-3 Packers. cabbage.
That's where the sauerkraut goes. The guy stands in it, and then they use the pitchforks to get it out, and then it goes in your brats.
Kind of like crushing grapes with your feet, right? You just stand in it, and away it goes.
I wonder if she knows that. She's so proud of that crowd. That's a good crowd. You know where it came from?
Final play, barring a defensive foul here in the third period. And Brett Favre is taken down after a one-yard pickup. As the period ends, we played three. It's Green Bay 7, Philadelphia 3. And Monday Night Football resumes after this message from our ABC station on ESPN. Follows the game on ABC, your late local news, except on the West Coast. We start the fourth quarter in Green Bay. Al Michaels, John Madden, and Lisa Guerrero. Green Bay trying to pull to within one game of Minnesota in the NFC North. Philadelphia trying to stay within one game of Dallas. If Green Bay wins tonight, the Cowboys will have a two-game lead in the NFC East. And on second and nine, Favre off the fake, going deep. Good coverage, and the pass is incomplete. Crowd wants a penalty. Donald Driver looks for a flag and gets none. The coverage by Sheldon Brown.
You know, when you talk about maximum protection, that's exactly what the Packers did. They put Kevin Berry, an extra tackle, in as a tight end. He just blocked. They blocked solid. It was just a two-man pattern. Look, here's Kevin Berry over here. Block, block, block. You got a pattern here and a pattern here. Two men going out. So you block everything up, and this is the pass you're going to throw. You're going to throw it to Donald Driver. You just get it out there. You know that protection is not going to be a problem, so Brett Favre can wind up, put everything into it just like that.
Third and nine, Favre out of the shotgun. Here come the Eagles. The pass is thrown underneath to Javon Walker, and he is rolled down by Sheldon Brown. So Brown covers deep, Brown covers short, and Green Bay is forced to punt.
You know, Brett Favre went from a 63-yard pass. That ball was in the air, that second down one, for 63 yards to a none.
With a fractured thumb.
Right. Well, he tried to air one out, and, you know, and that's the thing. You're second and long. You know, make a play. Make them think that you will do it, so they just can't sit on you.
Bidwell's kick. A short one, bouncing with the 40. Fielded by Reno Mahe. And nobody's there to help him out as Mahe gets taken down up at the 36-yard line. Now the Eagles will begin this drive with McNabb. 54 seconds into the fourth quarter in a four-point game. Favre's wife and daughter. There was Donald Driver and his son, Tony Fisher, walking the runway. The Baja Villamila family. Javon Walker. What do you think Vince Lombardi would have said about all this?
What the hell's going on out here?
Probably would have.
That's exactly what Vince Lombardi is probably saying right now. Vince Lombardi, to me, the greatest coach of all time.
And his tenure here, you look at that, those figures, you forget how short it was, only nine seasons. From the 36-yard line, it's incomplete, intended for James Thrash, covered by Mike McKenzie, but nine memorable seasons for Lombardi, including,
you know, how
he was Super Bowl the first 2 years.
You know, as a kid, you always say what you want to be when you grow up. If you're a coach, you always wanted to be this guy when you grew up.
The Packers took the Eagles on in the championship game in 60. It's the only championship game that Lombardi lost. The Eagles winning the crown, winning the game 17-13.
You remember who the Eagle quarterback was?
Terrell Buckholder. Well, the Eagle quarterback was the former Ram quarterback, and the guy went on to become a pretty decent coach.
And a heck of a guy, too, Norm Van Brocklin.
Absolutely.
The old Dutchman. And that was the thing, you know, I was with the Eagles in 1959 and got hurt, and Chuck Bednarik was there, and he retired the last game of the season in 59. Now he comes back in 1960 and not only plays again, but plays both ways, center and linebacker. I mean, he was the last really true two-way player in the National Football League. And that was the championship game that he won. Number 60 was Chuck Bednarik.
Here's McNabb now on third down and 11. And that pass is caught on a slant by Pinkston. But if he doesn't make the first down, it's because Antoine Edwards came up to stop him. And you can see the head linesman's going to put the ball down right at the 45. And even though the yellow line is unofficial, when there's that much of a separation between the line and where the ball is, chances are it is not a first down. They'll bring the chains out nonetheless.
Yeah, the Packers just had a three-man rush, so they had eight men in coverage. But watch Pinkston and Al Harris here on the line of scrimmage. Al Harris is always going to be physical with you. Pinkston knows that, so you start into him, let him be physical, and then run off that. But I don't think he ran off it for enough. And Andy Reid is going to have to punt here.
No question about this, as he has to try to pin Green Bay deep and get it back again near midfield, fourth down and inches with under 13 minutes to play.
Al Harris talking to the official there. I'm sure that Pinkston said, hey, he held me. And Al Harris was saying, no, I didn't hold anyone.
Dirk Johnson ready to punt for the seventh time tonight.
The guys with the markers are still out there. Let's get off the field. There you go. They stayed out there like they were going to measure it again.
Antonio Chapman to run it back. A fair catch was called for, but then Chapman slipped. And that enables the Eagles to pick up a few more yards as it rolls to the 9-yard line. 46-yard move. 7-3 Green Bay in the fourth. 56 yards on 24 carries. And here he goes again. And he picks up four. I mentioned before, Jim Taylor holds the rushing mark for Green Bay. He said in 1962, Taylor rushed for 1,474 yards in a 14-game season. There's some of the salient points about Taylor. As you can see, the only guy to ever beat out Jim Brown in Brown's 9-year NFL career to win a rushing crown. It's a 41-year-old record. It's the longest single game or single team record of any rusher still existing in the National Football League, as Amon Green takes it up to the 15. So that has been in for a team that, you know, normally rushes the ball, built for cold weather and all that. It's amazing that Taylor's mark has stood for 41 years.
You know, the other thing that's amazing about Jim Taylor and that mark, he was a fullback. And the fullback is a position that is darn near obsolete today. And it used to be that the fullback would run maybe half the time, maybe even more than a halfback. The halfback on that team was Paul Hornung when Jim Taylor was making all those yards. And now they don't even have the position.
Sure.
I mean,
apart from somebody like a Mike Allstott, who's pretty much a hybrid, a fullback rarely gains 250 yards in a season. Favre throws, and that pass is incomplete. He is under pressure, intended for Najee Davenport. Favre wanted a flag.
Yeah, this isn't a Brett Favre night. I mean, he just, you know, he has Amon Green running, and that's about all they got going in that screen pass, you know, just before half. But other than that, neither one of these offenses have been able to put anything together. But the Eagles right here should be getting pretty good field position.
Bidwell kicking to Reno Mahe from the 42. And their pretty good field position will be the 46-yard line. As McNabb and company come back out with 11 minutes to play in the fourth quarter in a very pivotal game for both teams. 7-3 Green Bay. Philadelphia Eagles trailing 7-3 begin the drive. Terrell Buckhalter is the running back. McNabb in the pocket. Hit as he throws. The ball is floating. And coming back to get it is James Thrash. And Thrash is inside the 10 all the way to the 2-yard line. And what a break for Philadelphia. Cletus Hunt put the pressure on that time. Hits McNabb as he throws. The ball floats. He comes back to make the catch, and it's first and goal.
Yeah, we were just talking about that. James Thrash, up to this point, had only caught one pass for 4 yards. And you say, at some point, they have to get the ball to the wide receivers. One of the wide receivers has to make a play, and that guy was James Thrash on that play right there. You see, it's that fade stop. So he's going like he's going to run it out. Then he just stops. And as he stops, Mike McKenzie, the corner, runs right by him. That play is getting more and more popular in this game where you run that fade, and you see he just gets hit as he throws it, and they run the fade stop, and he was in perfect position for it.
And now a timeout is taken by Philadelphia to get their short yardage group in as McNabb hit as he throws, McKenzie with the coverage, and then Thrash comes back and takes it inside the five.
You know, and I think it shows you how strong Donovan McNabb is to be able to throw a ball like that as you're getting hit. Now, it's not a great-looking throw. It wobbles out of there, but have enough power and strength to get that much velocity on the ball to get it that deep.
So now the Eagles...
McNabb saying, hey, man, you knocked the heck out of me on that play.
Eagles trying to stay within a game of Dallas. The winner of this game will be one game out in its division. The loser, two games behind, with seven to go.
But Andy Reid and his Eagles just kind of hang in there the whole game, don't they?
Pretty much the story of the season. McNabb throws it into the bleachers. You know, John, when we talked about it at the beginning of the year, they lost the first two games at home. 17-0 on opening night to Tampa, 31-10 to New England in the next game. But there they are in games decided by eight or fewer points. And as we said earlier, again, they trail in the second half as they have in each of their last three wins. But they're winning the close games, and that's why they're 5-3.
Right, and everyone says they win games that they shouldn't, but that's coaching. That's hanging in there. That's staying with it. You know, I will say this, it's second down, and then they have a third down, but if they don't get it on second or third down, I think they still have to kick a field goal.
Second and goal. They give it to Deuce Staley, and Staley takes it inside the one where he's hit by Barnett. So Barnett, for the moment, saves the touchdown. Third down and goal inside the one-yard line.
Yeah, and they have their big guys in there now. Gilbert Brown and Grady Jackson are both in there, so that's why Nick Barnett is free. When you have, like, 700 pounds of defensive linemen right in the middle, the linebacker that's right behind him is usually going to be free. Look at that. I don't know where I'm going to run, but I know I'm not going to run right at this stuff right here. That's too doggone big, even for old Hank Fraley and the guys.
And with Cletus Hunt in there, he's a pup at 3:05. Third and goal. The fake. McNabb rolling left. Gonna run it in. Can he get there? Yes. Touchdown. What an effort. And then Deuce Staley reaches over to hug him.
They've hung in there. McNabb made that big throw when he had to as he was getting hit. And here he makes this play right here. You see, there's nothing inside. He rolls outside. He has no one open. Now he knows this is third down. I better get this thing in. Now McNabb, a quarterback, ran that one in like a fullback.
Got to the goal line. Gets it in. Eagles have the lead for the first time tonight, with 9:22 remaining in the fourth.
Donovan McNabb's mother and father are both here, and he says his dad talked to him about the football, and his mother talked to him about his jersey not being tucked in or him not running off the field. Don't be walking out there, she said.
High snap. Detmer pulls it down. Akers bangs it through. McNabb with his first rushing touchdown of the season. So the persevering Philadelphia Eagles take the lead 10-7. Donovan McNabb, his Philadelphia Eagles this season have given up more points than they've scored. If this score holds, that will remain true, and the team would go to 6-3. At the 12-yard line, it's Antonio Chapman. Up to the 34-yard line. And Brett Favre comes back out. L.J. Smith makes the tackle on the run back. And there are the very un-Favre-like numbers for number four.
And he knows that he has to make some plays now. That Donovan McNabb, he'll play the whole game, didn't make many plays, but he needed a couple of it. I mean, he got that ball to James Thrash as he was getting hit. And then on third down, he got the ball in the end zone. And Brett Favre is going to have to make some plays on this drive.
For neither team will this be a pretty victory, except in the standings. At the 34-yard line, Favre throws, caught, first down, Donald Driver, who's been fairly silent tonight. Tackled there by Troy Vincent for Donald Driver, his second catch for 18 yards.
Now if you need a play by your quarterback, Brett Favre isn't a bad quarterback to need a play from. I mean, you just look, you know, we talk about how much he enjoys the game and enjoys playing it. He enjoys these situations too. I mean, this is not a stressful thing for him. This is a fun, stressful thing.
Loves it, and it shows from the 46-yard line. Favre slings it to midfield, caught by Green, slips down, gets into Eagle territory, stopped at the 48. It'll be second down and 4.
I'll tell you what he's had on these last two passes. He had very good pass protection. And I know what that means to Jim Johnson, the defensive coordinator of the Eagles, is if they're protected, he's getting too much time, I'm going to blitz on this down.
Gotcha.
The Green Bay offensive front, which has played magnificently this year. And then coming across the line, N.D. Kalu knocking over
Ball
Bubba Franks.
88 offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
And it's Franks who precipitated it.
Right, and that's why N.D. Kalu came across the line. And that's the thing that really gets coaches upset. I mean, you have a second and 5 situation, which is a great situation. You know, and then you have your tight end move like that, and now you get back to second and long.
Been a while since we've seen Bill Carollo. That's the first penalty of the half. On second and 9, the pass is thrown out of bounds. Donald Driver was blanketed by Troy Vincent. Excuse me, Javon Walker by Troy Vincent.
And you see how a little thing like a tight end moving early changes the whole thing. Now instead of, you know, second and 5, then you're second and long. And then even if you were incomplete off second, instead of being third and 4 or 5, now you're third and long. And now you're going to get nickel, and you're going to get all their blitzes and all these things that the Eagles do.
Third and 9, they have to get to the Philadelphia 44-yard line. Walker in motion out of the backfield. Eagles showing blitz. How many will come? 5. And the pass is caught by Ferguson. He reaches out, makes the catch, but he's short of the first down. It was all Ferguson could do to catch it, so he had to reach for it, and he stopped short of the first at the 45-yard line, fourth down.
And the Packers are going to go for it. On that blitz, what they did is Jim Johnson will overload a side, get one more rusher than you have blocking. You see, he overloads the side there, so he's always going to have a free rusher on that situation. Now, this, to me, would be a running situation.
And on fourth and 1, they give the ball to Green. First down, and inside the 20, inside the 10, touchdown, 45 yards. I'll say it was a running situation.
It sure was. It was kind of set up by Brett Favre getting rid of that ball on that slant and setting up a fourth and short. You're going to see they just get everyone packed in here. Look at this. They packed the whole defense to the inside. Then he just finds that crease in there, and he just sprints right through it. They, all he was looking for was to pick up a first down, and look what he found.
Longwell for the extra point. 187 yards for Green. Plus 32 in the air. His second touchdown of the game. 14-10 Green Bay. He's been a Monday night star this year. His career high 176-yard game came in the Monday nighter at Chicago at the end of September. He has eclipsed that tonight. 187, bearing down on Dorsey Levin's single game record for a Packer. 190 yards set in 1997.
That's bringing these Milwaukee Green Bay Packer fans back into this one, isn't it?
The whole Badger State in unison. Longwell's kick fielded at the 8-yard line by James Thrash, who had a big run back to begin the second half. And Thrash breaks out of the pack, and then Najee Davenport finally bangs him out of bounds in Green Bay territory at about the 47-yard line. 45-yard run back to the touchdown. Fourth and one here.
Let's watch it. Here's Kevin Berry. We talked about him coming in as a third tackle. Watch the block that he gets here and then knocks the middle linebacker, Mark Cimino, off. You see, he gets, boom, he gets that going back. That knocks the middle linebacker off, and then Amon Green is right by him. You watch Marco Rivera and Mark Towson and their blocks here. I mean, that is some blocking by that offensive line.
First and 10, ball at the 47 of Philadelphia after Thrash's good run back again. And now Deuce Staley powers his way before he's tackled by Sharper to the 42-yard line for a gain of 5.
Did you see how quick Grady Jackson was there? I mean, he exploded for a 360, 370-pound guy. He got here like 2 or 3 days ago. I mean, he could really explode. Watch him. He's right here. Now watch how quickly he gets to this point right here. I mean, that's what you want, penetration. Mm. Look at that. I mean, that guy is light on his feet, and that's a lot of weight over his feet to be light on.
Former Oakland Raider, former Saint. They released him last week. And then a swing pass is thrown here to John Ritchie as the fullback gets upended by McKenzie. Very close to a first down. And they're going to measure here at the 37-yard line.
I think the Eagles now, you know, they just have to methodically go down the field here. Now, this is going to be a tight situation here because last time they had the ball, there were 10 or 11 minutes to go. So if they didn't get the touchdown, I felt they had to go for the field goal, then go for another field goal. In this situation with the time, depends on how much time they run off the clock, because this could still be right now, it could still be a 2-field goal game for the Eagles.
At the moment, depending how quick they can get down there. First down to the 37-yard line. 5.5 to go in the fourth. McNair protected well. Going deep for Thrash. Pass incomplete. Some incidental contact along the way. McKenzie one-on-one with him. Second down.
Yeah, and that was they had the safety back there, too. McKenzie wasn't back there by himself, and I think that McNabb tried to hit him between the corner and the safety.
McKenzie gassed as he comes back.
He's gassed because his hair is so long, he's pulling his head back. That's a look of gassed. That will happen to you when your hair is that long. It'll pull you back and make you look like you're gasping for gas.
Makes Al Harris look like he has a crew cut. Second and 10 from the 37. McNabb throws, caught. That's Freddie Mitchell making the catch, and he's taken down at the 32-yard line by Nile Diggs. Big third down coming up here.
Yeah, what'll even be bigger is if they don't pick up this third down, the fourth down. I think with well, we're going to be at 4.5 minutes. I think you'd probably still kick a field goal. Although, I mean, if you're an Eagle, what you want is you want a first down here.
What you're looking at, though, is about a 50-yard field goal if they gain no more yardage in these conditions. Third down and 5 from the 32. McNabb swings it to Staley, and he drops it. So now your choice becomes, do you go for it, or do you take a chance on a 49 or 50-yard field goal, which, if you miss, gives Green Bay the ball at about the 40-yard line?
I would think you kick the field goal. And it doesn't look like that's what Andy Reid is going to do. He's going to go for it on fourth down. I think with this much time, you know, and having 2 timeouts left, I think you have time to kick a field goal. But as you say, it's a longer field goal. Get the ball back and then go for another field goal.
I think, John, the conditions were better. I might try the field goal, but under these conditions, and we saw what happened to Longwell before. Meanwhile, Green Bay will take a timeout. Remember, Longwell missed for the first time this season, and he missed short. 14-10 Green Bay with 4.5 to go in a good one at Lambeau. Teams back in the NFC North. The Niners a bye after their big one over the Rams. Next Monday, Pittsburgh at San Francisco. Now it's 4th and 5. The Eagles going for it from the 32-yard line of Green Bay. McNabb under pressure, hit, throws, incomplete. Big time pressure by Antoine Edwards and Hannibal Navies. So Ed Donatell, the defensive coordinator, calls for the blitz, and it comes up big.
Yeah, fourth down, and they knew that it had to be in Donovan McNabb's hand, that it had to be a passing play. So Ed Donatell, instead of dropping off, is going to bring him. He lines up in a three-man line, and you think you're going to get coverage, and instead you get the whole thing coming right at you. Donovan McNabb didn't have a chance on that one. You don't think Brett Favre loves his defense right about now?
And his offense comes on the field right now. Philadelphia has to begin to think about taking its timeouts. They have two, plus a two-minute warning. From the 32-yard line, here is Green. He gets tackled at the 32-yard line, and the Eagles at this point will still not take the timeout.
Yeah, see, because they only have two, I think what you want to do is wait until after you stop them on second down. Then if you do that, then you can take it second down, third down, and then change of possession in 2 minute and all those things.
Put him in a third and long and stop the clock. Meanwhile, Brett Favre just looking at the play clock right now, which is at 16 and 15, and then they'll get the snap off at 2-1 and milk it.
Had the Eagles had three timeouts, they probably would have taken one there.
Second down and 9 from the 33. Green. And Michael Lewis is there, but then Green picks up two more running through Lewis to the 37-yard line. And now you're kind of in no man's land if you are the Philadelphia Eagles, and they still won't take the timeout. They will if they can stop them here, but they can milk another half minute off the clock and take it down to 3 minutes. On that run, by the way, Green eclipsed Dorsey Levin's single-game record, going to 192. Levin's at 190, so there is your all-time Green Bay single game rushing mark.
Congratulations to Dorsey Levin. If I were the Eagles, I would have taken time out there after second down.
Third down and 5 out of the power eye set. Ooh, it almost jumped. They take it down to 1. And then the pass is caught by Henderson on the outside. He's tackled there by Wayne, and now the timeout is taken. So they will get the ball back, most likely deep in their own territory if it's a decent punt, and there's one timeout plus the 2 minute warning. Monday Night Football being brought to you by City Identity Theft Solutions. Free help getting your life back. That's using your card wisely. Wendy's new homestyle chicken strips, another reason it's better here. And Toyota, get the feeling. Well, we're set up for another good finish. How about, you know, last week, just a postscript to last week's game, when Bill Belichick made that great call, the intentional safety, and they came back to win the game. In the history of the National Football League, some 80-plus years, it's the only time a team has allowed a safety, intentional or otherwise, in the last 3 minutes of the game and won the game while trailing, as was the case with New England.
Well, they got that, and then on the free kick, the Broncos kind of misread that kick, and that helped them too.
No question. Fielded by Reno Mahe, the Bidwell punt, and he's out of bounds up at the 33-yard line. A little recap tonight, the conditions of the game, the ball is slick, the field was wet, and Brett Favre had that fumble in the first half. Amon Green fumbled, but before the half was done, he took that screen pass from Brett Favre and went in for the touchdown. Then Thrash came back to get the deflected throw by McNabb, and Donovan was able to take it into the end zone to give Philadelphia a 10-7 lead. But on a 4th and 1, Green goes 45 yards for a Packers score, and that's where we are right now with 2:43 left.
And now Donovan McNabb has to earn all the money they pay him. This is when they need Donovan McNabb to be a superstar.
And a 65-yard drive. And they give it to Deuce Staley. And he starts by gaining 7 on the ground. They can stop the clock twice, once of their own volition and once at the 2 minute warning.
Andy Reid is knowing that here he's thinking touchdown. You know, it's not getting in field goal range. Field goal range right now means nothing.
2nd and 3 up to the 42-yard line. McNabb, he's going to run it himself. He's going to pick up the first down. That's going to take the ball to the 46-yard line. And they will let the clock run down to the two-minute warning. So they save their final timeout, and they are 54 yards away from the end zone. Two-minute warning. Green Bay 14, Philadelphia 10. .com post-game show. Well, the horse trailer player of the game, Amon Green, at the moment would be the favorite. And if that happens, it would be the second time this season he'd go up there. Mike Sherman's team right now with the lead. Again, a very important game for both teams. Minnesota leading in the NFC North. Green Bay could shave it to a game. Dallas leading in the NFC East. Philly could shave it to a game. The winner is a game back. The loser is two games back.
You know how important this drive is to Andy Reid in calling plays here. When he calls Donovan McNabb on a quarterback draw play, you know that he needs a first down.
One timeout remaining for the Eagles from the 46-yard line. McNabb deep over the middle, and it's James Thrash who does not make the catch in bounds. Incomplete.
That was the play that they needed. That's the type of play that they do need. I mean, they didn't get it here, but they have to keep trying. They have to go for these kind of plays. Here Thrash is against Al Harris. That's a heck of a move. He makes an in move on him. Harris goes for the in cut, and James Thrash gets by him. You know, one thing, Al Harris doesn't have a lot of speed. I think Thrash knows that, and they tried to take advantage of Harris right there.
Edwards got his hand in there. He was on the chalk anyway. Second down and 10. And they give it to Staley, and Deuce picks up the first down. So it's a first down now at the 43-yard line. Conserving their final timeout, first and 10 at the 43.
I would think they would spike it here because they got a first down. He's taking way too much time.
McNabb over the middle. Here's Staley. Deuce trying to pick up the first. Appears to have it at the 32-yard line. 80 seconds to go. McNabb coolly getting up to the line, but I think at this point you think about spiking it. But no, valuable time running off the clock. McNabb making sure everybody is set. First and 10 at the 32. Donovan throws over the middle, caught inside the 15 by the tight end Chad Lewis. And now McNabb signals for his final timeout with 57 seconds. I think they would have been better served to spike it there and save that timeout.
Yeah, especially when they had the first down. They could have done it before, or the down before that. Or as you say, right here, when he had the first down, when he went over there to go timeout, he could have just ran up and spiked the ball.
Yeah, I don't think Andy Reid was necessarily thrilled with that timeout. McNabb looked to the officials, signaled timeout immediately, but why waste your last timeout in this circumstance instead of spiking it right here when you come to the line?
I'll tell you one thing, though. McNabb had to make plays, and he's making them. And the other thing is they're getting very good pass protection. You know, the Packers have been putting the heat all night on McNabb. On this drive, he's had a very good protection.
And McNabb, after a very slow start, closing in on a 200-yard game. Favre tonight has thrown for 87 yards, but the key has been Amon Green on that side. And now we'll see about the Eagles as they try to make it 6 out of 7. Down by 4. No timeouts left. Line of scrimmage will be the 12.
You know, I see Bao Ju is down here at this right corner now. Al Harris was in there. Remember that play we saw that Thrash beat him? Al Harris isn't in there now.
And Bao Ju, bottom of the screen, locked up on Todd Pinkston. McNabb from the 12. Gonna run it. Takes it down to the 6-yard line. He's tackled there by Marcus Anderson. It is second down, and it'll be 4, short 4.
Yeah, when you have a superstar and he's your top player and he's your top money maker, you have to put the game in his hands when you get in these situations, and that's exactly what Andy Reid is doing with Donovan McNabb.
On 2nd and 4, throwing to the corner of the end zone and caught by Todd Pinkston for the touchdown. He goes into the end zone and comes back to the pylon and makes the catch to give the Eagles the lead.
That was amazing. That was an amazing drive. They had to do it. You know, you look at the Eagles in the first half, and we say they just hang in there. They just hang in there. McNabb doesn't make a lot of plays. They didn't get real good pass protection. On this drive, they needed McNabb. They needed pass protection, and they got it.
Todd Pinkston, a starting wide receiver, has gone all season without a touchdown catch until now. Only the second touchdown catch by an Eagle wideout all year. Akers for the conversion, and it's 17-14 for an incredibly resilient football team that began its season by losing the first two, had a big one at Washington, lost to Dallas, but then had beaten the Giants, the Jets, Atlanta, and are 27 seconds away from knocking off the Packers.
They knew right where to go. Baugeau was in there. They said, let's work on him. They sell that slant and then go back to the corner, a slant corner. Now watch your protection. Watch your pump fake here. Donovan McNabb pump faked with both hands. And he pump faked when Pinkston started on that slant. He pumped it there. Watch it here. Watch the protection. The pump fake. That's the slant. And then he throws it back to the corner.
And again, the game is not over because that man's going to come back on the field. The Eagles to kick off. The Packers still have two timeouts. Not that they'll have enough time to use those, but if they get a decent run back and Favre sets them up in field goal range and Longwell is one of the best, who knows?
They smelled that one, didn't they? I mean, someone up in the booth did a good job of knowing that Al Harris was hurt or whatever happened to him, and you always go to the guy that they put in, and you go to work on him immediately, and that's exactly what the Eagles did.
The guy might as well have a neon sign on him.
That and a rookie. They do have neon signs on him.
Now David Akers to kick. Chapman is back to receive. Footed Akers bounces one to Chapman. He takes it at the 12, starts to lose his balance and seeks the sideline and gets there up at the 36-yard line. So now with 21 seconds left, they would have to get the ball to roughly the 35-yard line to give Akers a shot at it. So they need about 30 yards to give Akers a decent chance. Or I'm sorry, to give Longwell a decent chance to win the game or to tie it and send it into overtime. So the Green Bay Packers now at their own 36-yard line, first and 10.
And they can throw any type of pass. It doesn't have to be in the sideline because they have two timeouts.
Favre throws and it is caught. 50-yard line rolls. They take the timeout immediately. So you have 15 seconds. Two ways to go about it now. You still need about 15, 17 yards. Even if you throw it over the middle, you get up to the line of scrimmage and you still have time to spike it or you work it to the outside. Longwell's career long, 54. There are the standings as of the moment. Philly would go to 6-3 with a win. And it's imperative, I think, too, for the wide receivers, John, to understand if they make the catch in the middle of the field here, to go down and declare yourself down, and they will stop the clock.
Right, that's a big thing because they have the timeouts. They can do that. If they do get the ball in field goal range, go down and declare yourself down.
Favre throws. It's caught. It's caught by Walker, and Walker goes down at the 41-yard line. But the ball is a little short of the first down, and a timeout is taken by Green Bay.
Now, this is a tough situation because you need yardage to get into field position, but you're not going to have enough time to get the ball deep enough to get the field position and get your field goal team in there without any timeouts.
So now the ball is at the 41. Maybe the 42-yard line. You'd be looking at a 60-yard attempt
What I think the Packers have to do, Al, with only 8 seconds to go, I think they have to go for a touchdown. But I don't know that they can complete a pass, get in field goal range, get out of bounds, stop the clock, spike it, whatever, and have time to kick the field goal. And if that's true, I say they ought to go for the touchdown.
Their other option is a quick out to the sideline and get out of bounds.
I don't know that would put him close enough.
Far. He tried to do that. The ball comes loose, and the Philadelphia Eagles come up with a football. He lost the ball. It looked like he was trying to go to the outside, and the Eagles come up with the ball and the ball game.
I think it just slipped out of his hand again for the third time in this game. Remember, we saw the ones earlier. He's trying to throw that out. Yep, that's exactly what happened. The ball just slips out of his hands. The Eagles did a good job because they knew that they were going to try and do that, so they were protecting the boundaries. There was no way that they were going to let them get that ball to the outside and get out of bounds.
They are going to review this upstairs to see whether it was a fumble or whether it was an incomplete pass. If it's an incomplete pass, Green Bay still has the ball, and they would still have one shot at a Hail Mary to end the game.
Right, they ruled on the field, they ruled fumble. The referee threw his beanbag, ruling fumble. And then, as you say, it's a booth review if they review it.
So Favre with the empty hand as the ball comes loose.
An empty hand means fumble.
If this stands, the Eagles will have won a fourth straight game coming from behind in the second half. This is not a challengeable call within 2 minutes of either half. It is initiated by the officials upstairs, so they take a look at it. And then in consultation with the referee, it is determined what the call is. But the Eagles are confident that regardless of what's going to happen here, they're going to fly back east with their sixth win in 7 games. Here comes Bill Carollo.
If they say incomplete pass, the Packers are going to get one more shot at it. I think it was a fumble. I think he ruled fumble, and it was.
After reviewing the play, it's been determined the quarterback's arm was going forward without the ball. Therefore, it's a loose ball fumble. Recovery by Philadelphia, first down.
The crowd misinterpreted what Carollo was saying. They thought, by virtue of what he initially said, it was going to go in Green Bay's favor. It doesn't.
He said because his arm was going forward and the crowd started to yell, but he didn't have the ball in his hand when his arm went forward.
John, there you are in 71. 4 consecutive wins when your team was trailing by 3 or more points in the second half, and the Eagles will join that list right now and come away with a victory at Lambeau Field and proving to be an unbelievably resilient football team to keep plugging away after that disastrous beginning to the season and put themselves in a good position for a second half playoff run and find themselves just a game back of the Dallas Cowboys in the NFC East. Meanwhile, Green Bay with a golden chance to get within a game of Minnesota, and those two teams have already met twice and split the season series. The Vikings get a break because Green Bay remains 2 games back. So Philadelphia at the end with a win. And coming up next will be the AutoTrader.com post-game show when we wrap it up from Green Bay, Wisconsin.